In the late 1980s, Christina Gallagher was a young Irish housewife of simple tastes and modest means from the west coast of Ireland. At that time, Christina was completely unaware her life would be dramatically changed during a visit to Dublin on January 21, 1988. It was on that day that Christina received the first of two apparitions in a week of the Blessed Virgin Mary, saying, "Suddenly, I found myself looking at a beautiful lady in midair, above the floor. All else was gone. She was radiantly beautiful and actually radiated light." Here is an excerpt of an early interview with Christina and her longtime spiritual director, Father Gerard McGinty, as she discusses her early experiences with the Blessed Mother.
"As I see this lady, she's not only beautiful, but what I experience from her is greater than beauty. It's peace beyond peace, a peace that I cannot and never have found in this world, a love where I feel totally fulfilled in the pureness which I feel is truly the pureness of the love of God."
"And how did this leave you feeling? I mean, how did she depart? Would she depart slowly, and how did you feel afterwards?"
"Yes, our Blessed Mother would depart slowly and begin to fade, and then she would be gone. And my experience after her, or while she was going and after her having gone, would be the sense of loss, the loss of a mother. I loved this lady so much. I desired to stay with her always, because the reality was, she was my mother. God was my Father in heaven, God the Father, Jesus, my Lord and Redeemer, but also my brother. The Holy Spirit, my guide and enlightener in the wisdom of God. And her being the reality, the world was no longer the real. Home and heaven was the reality, and this world the journey."
"I see in the picture of her, Blessed Lady, that there's a brightness over her heart. Was that in the apparition?"
"In the second apparition, when our Blessed Mother appeared with Saint Bernadette, from a distance, when she appeared, I could see a great glow of light over her breast. When she came up close, that light was the Eucharist in the center, and the glow of light was round the edge. And it was the Eucharist she had over her heart."
"And did she ever say anything about the Eucharist when she would speak to you?"
"Well, she referred to love Jesus in the Blessed Sacrament. She desires all her children to come back to Jesus, her Son. And as a mother, she desires to lead her children back to Jesus, her Son. And to pray the rosary from our hearts. In praying the rosary from our hearts, it consists that she wants us to know what we're saying and who we're saying it to say it slowly."
"Did you always find the rosary an easy prayer?"
"No, and in fact, I said the rosary very fast. Like a lot of people will say it fast, and that's the quickest way. Sometimes it might be very boring. But if people were to realize that our mother is not just appearing to me, she is before every heart, she loves all our children equal, and if they could realize that their mother is waiting for their offering of this prayer, she's waiting with a heart full of love to hear the response of her child speaking to her. There's nothing as beautiful as to say, 'Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus.' In the sense of communication, to offer her that simple words from your heart, knowing that you're talking to your mother, not talking to an alien or someone that's non-existent. She's very much in existence and very much before every heart. When God chose our Blessed Mother and the very day for to bring Jesus to the world as our Lord and Redeemer, and why should we go to God, you know, to start with, why can't we go through the intercession of a mother that loves us? We can go to him through her and with her intercession, and it can be only more powerful."
In a third apparition in February, Mary would say,
"Be not afraid. I am the Virgin Mary, Queen of Peace, and I come in peace. I say to all the people who find it difficult to accept my messages and those of my Son, pray the rosary from your hearts. all three mysteries for 9 days. Offer these prayers to my son's heart and to the Holy Spirit for enlightenment. If you do that, you will understand.
In addition to speaking the rosary, Christina also explains what our Blessed Mother had to say about love, suffering, and the cross.
So Blessed Mother referred to the rosary as being a weapon, and how it is a weapon if we live, as it were, the life of Jesus with our Blessed Mother in the rosary, and praying it from our heart. In the joyful mystery, we can clearly see our Blessed Mother's humility and yes to God. In the sorrowful mysteries, we can clearly see the ugliness of our sin, which crucified Jesus. And in the glorious mysteries, the beauty again of the resurrected Christ, how he triumphed over death and triumphed over our death and redeemed us. Again, if we, in the joyful mystery, respond as the Blessed Mother did in our humility and yes to God, we can make up for our own sins. That we can bring to Jesus souls, not only our own souls, but we can make reparation for others, because we're all part of the mystical body of Christ, and we're all brothers and sisters in Christ. And in that ways, be united with Christ in the resurrection.
You mentioned that we're all members of the body of Christ, and we can help each other. Would you like to talk a little more about?
Yes, well, what was given to me clearly was that all our souls, through the redemption, Jesus redeemed all our souls, and all our souls united makes the mystical body of Christ. And none of us can be divided. As Jesus said, love one another. He meant us to love one another and be united in unity. In that way, we permit his body to be united. But as the sin in the world goes on, we are tearing the mystical body apart in a much greater ways than ever happened at Calvary. And it will go on till Jesus cleanses the earth of all evil and sin.
During those early years, Christina was given a first-class education by the Mother of God, was able to see Jesus at different times, both in his glorified and his crucified body, and also walking and teaching the apostles during their formation. It was also during the period 1988 to 1991 that Christina received gifts from God, including the gifts of prophecy, wisdom, healing, and infused knowledge, where she was able to see and understand the very essence of a person, including their sins, past and future. She also saw purgatory. Here is how she described those events.
I began to recognize on different occasions the different sufferings that was given to me, that some of them were for priests, other times it was for souls in purgatory. And there were times when I would see the souls in purgatory. I have seen them, souls in purgatory, in the house of prayer and on many other different occasions. Sometimes like normal human people, and then they would be there, seeing them with my eyes and then disappear. Other times, like coming from Holy Communion, I would kneel down, and the holy souls, a person would come and kneel down beside me. When I would look, there was no person there. Again, I would have the inner awareness of it being a soul from purgatory. Many souls from purgatory have come to me, as God desires many times to offer a particular suffering for priests. Sometimes I might see the priests, as in one occasion I seen a priest. I didn't know who this priest was. A number of weeks later, I was in Fatima, and in the place I was staying, I recognized the priest. I thought, well, I've seen you somewhere before, and then recognized where I'd seen him and what he had been suffering, because I'd been shown what he'd been suffering, and that God desired the particular suffering I was enduring at that time for this priest. And then I called the priest to one side, because I wouldn't be happy enough, especially when I seen the priest. I suppose I'm a bit of Doubting Thomas. I have to sort of
make sure,
research it out and say it to the priest, because I felt he was there for a reason. So when I told the priest of my experience, and I was lightly with telling him what I endured, but at the same time I gave him quite enough of he would know what I was talking about. And I said, Father, if you want to hear it more bluntly, I'll do that. Then the priest jumped up and looked very nervous and said, I understand that that was exactly me a few weeks ago. Yeah. And all of a sudden, I knew what the priest was thinking, his sins of the past, what he had done. And even if I wanted to at that time, I couldn't stop, because once I start telling the priest something of his life, it would be like I would be led deeper and deeper, and I had no control over it.
The Blessed Mother first requested Christina to establish a house of prayer in Achill on the west coast of Ireland as a place for both people and priests to come and pray. This was no easy task, as the money needed to be raised and the building that was chosen was full of corrosion and rot, requiring much repair. On December 7, 1992, St. Patrick appeared to Christina, telling her the house is a symbol of the church and the corruption in the house needed to be stripped out, just as the entire church needed to be stripped. Then, with no knowledge of construction, Christina was able to go through the entire building, pointing out one problem after the next which needed removal, including a roof replacement, which was full of rot. The Blessed Virgin Mary would explain to Christina,
I desire to gather my children together. You, my child, pray the rosary with my children as I have taught you. I will be present in the house with many angels. I entrust you with this. Do not be afraid. There is no place for fear. There is to be love, no disunity. I will disperse the darkness and surround you with light. Yet my children must be alert, be pure of heart, and love one another. And pray my beautiful rosary with love from your heart. My child, look at my many priest sons. Will you help me? I desire to bring them into the light of salvation. My child, you must pray, pray, pray. The devil wants to destroy my plan for Ireland and the world, but your prayer and sacrifice offered to my son will disarm all snares. I will give you many graces that you are in need of through prayer. Pray my beautiful rosary often. My son Jesus desires great work from you. Respond to his love.
And Jesus would add the following to his mother's words. It was I who desired a house of prayer. My words have been spoken through the heart of my mother, for she calls her children. But they do not hear. My little one, take heed. This house will be a refuge, for the remnant who hear and follow the cries of my mother's heart will come to you. Make available your time in life and pray with them. The Blessed Mother added,
if my children could recognize the gift of my house of prayer, they would be helping you, as the people helped Noah build the ark, and they would be queuing up to enter it.
After 2 years and great effort by Christina and others, on July 16, 1993, the House of Prayer was consecrated by Archbishop Joseph Cassidy at Holy Mass in Achill, Ireland. Here is the footage of the Mass held in the House Chapel. It was in 1995, the Blessed Mother told Christina she wanted to have a chain of houses of prayer created in other places, and today there are three more houses of prayer in America, located in Texas, Minnesota, and Florida. Very recently, at the specific direction of Jesus, a house of prayer is under construction in New York, which is urgently needed. More on that later. In 1990, Christina predicted the earthquake in Iran 3 weeks before it killed 50,000 people. In 1992, Christina predicted the War of Chechnya with Russia, which occurred in 1994. In 1993, Christina predicted the genocide in Rwanda by the Hutu that killed 500,000 to 1 million Tutsi in 1994. In 1995, Christina was shown dramatic weather events like mudslides, tornadoes, and volcanic eruptions in unusual places throughout the world where these events were extremely unlikely. In 1986 and thereafter, Christina began predicting the 2004 tsunami in the Indian Ocean that killed hundreds of thousands in several countries. Also, that more tsunamis will follow in different places. In 1999, during a visit to New York, Christina told Judge Dan Lynch, who was marveling at the impressive towers, that if America did not make reparation to God for sin, the Twin Towers would come down. Let's listen to Christina herself as she talks about the Twin Towers, stock market crash, and what may or may not occur in New York, California, and elsewhere in the United States. During a visit to New York in early October 2019, Mrs. Gallagher related messages and prophecy on a variety of very important subjects pertaining to the United States and elsewhere. Here is a portion of her talk which begins with her discussing the shifting of various plates under the earth, which are in danger of causing quakes in many places.
And as I so often experienced a noise and crackling, for going back for months now, of the plates, and there's one on the verge of slipping to go under, and if it goes under in this particular place, I feel that there could be an enormous tsunami. For who? Is it worldwide, or America, or the bordering countries? I don't know, but I do know there's going to be a huge earthquake very, very soon in California. Now, this is just like the Twin Towers. I am saying it as certain as I'm stood here. But just like our Lord wants to protect New York, but it's as if I read from what I hear from the Lord, California is nearly gone beyond saving, because there's no one that has time for light, only darkness. And the place is saturated in such filth through sin, beyond any place. And that says a lot, because New York is not an awful lot behind it, but yet the Lord cries out and sees his mercy, a hope, through people that want, through their free will, to save New York. There are other parts of America, as he said, you know, when you hear this climate change, it's utter nonsense. Nothing so much greater rubbish. It's the hand of God coming upon the world that's coming to crush sin that's taking place. And the melting of the ice and all that's happening is as the earth recognizes its creator. And it will get worse, and so will all the activity of the earth. Like when I was told that the twisters and the different things would be in unfamiliar places. Shortly after, there was twisters and I forget what storms there was now in Ireland, in Belmullet. Mudslides, yes. And pulled some of the land away, which there was a graveyard. And it pulled some of the graveyard into the sea. Will that likewise, but in a much greater way, will happen round the coastline, and especially in California. And there'll be many chunks of the coastline just torn into the sea.
Yeah, at the moment of death, Christina was shown exactly what takes place. The soul becomes aware of what the body
has confined it to and condemned it to, and at the moment of death, as the soul leaves the body, it moves towards the light of God. And it's in this light of God that the soul perceives itself. It's not as if God condemns the soul to hell or God sends the soul to purgatory. As the soul enters the light, the soul is aware of what the body has condemned it to, so it doesn't contest truth. It actually enters into the reality of truth, and the soul then plunges itself into whatever level of purgatory is required for its full purification, and is grateful to God for the gift of purgatory, because it knows that that is the only way in which it can achieve full purification, which will lead to direct union with God in the light of heaven. And a soul that has already condemned itself to hell will go to hell directly, because the light is more painful to a soul in darkness. It couldn't bear the light. So God is not to be blamed for anything. We take the consequences of our own lives at the moment of judgment and death.
Importantly, Jesus told Christina that three worst sins that grieve him are abortion, child abuse, and child sacrifice. Although abortion continues to be legal in this country, there is clearly movement in the direction of limiting abortion, moving towards making it illegal. Unfortunately, New York State has gone to the extreme of passing a law contrary to federal guidelines, permitting abortion even in the ninth month. Others are working on laws indicating that if a baby is born alive after an abortion, it can't be given life-saving measures. There is no other way to say it other than we are living in a country that promotes child sacrifice, otherwise known as infanticide. This puts us in the same place as ancient Israel, where children were sacrificed at the altar of the pagan god Baal, so the parents would be blessed with good things in their lives. The king of Israel was warned that if he allowed child sacrifice to continue, he would be killed. Instead of God, he obeyed his wife, who promoted the murder of innocents, and he was killed. Shortly after, Israel was conquered. A replica of the Temple of Baal, symbol of child sacrifice, has been exhibited in New York and Washington, D.C. in 2018 and 2019. America upside down. Christina suffers the many pains God sends her, which are both physical and mental. Her prayers and sacrifices are used by God to heal the sick, to free souls from purgatory, for people's intentions, and importantly, for the salvation and well-being of priests. The Blessed Mother has said, "The most important is healing the cancer of the soul."
And what kind of way does he introduce suffering to you?
Well, there's many ways, from the mockery of people not understanding, thinking for some reason I want to gain popularity or gain some unknown attention to myself, which in my heart and soul I have no desire for attention. In fact, I desire to wait hidden in the background. And I feel a responsibility yet to God to proclaim the message that our Blessed Mother gave to me. So for that reason, I give the message as best I can, and yet through the humiliation of whatever anyone will throw at me, the one thing I keep in mind is, this is not my work. This is God and our Blessed Mother's work I have to fulfill. Saying that, there's other kind of suffering, such as attacks from the evil one. There is even to the point of him leaving marks on me. But again, saying that, nothing really scares me, other than I would be frightened if I didn't do the will of God and what was asked of me.
What's the inner suffering like? I mean, you say that it would be greater when nothing would be visible.
It's hard to describe the inner suffering. It's like as if I'm in a dark tunnel, the abandonment of God, the yearning for God, It's like sometimes when I experience that, I'm going about the house or wherever I am as if in search. I'm searching for God, but I'm not even aware that I'm searching actually for God. I'm searching for something, and then I sit down and I say, what am I doing? And I'm actually searching to feel the fulfillment again and not to feel the abandonment. It's a terrible feeling to feel the emptiness and the abandonment of God, especially at a time when I feel practically crucified from every kind of suffering there is at that particular time.
Also, as seen here, Christina suffered the wounds of Christ crucified on her feet in 1995, and the four stigmata of the crown of thorns on her forehead in 1999. Father McGinnity would also make the point that the devil uses the twin torments of pride and fear against priests to stop them from bravely proclaiming the Word of God and the laws of the Church. The Bible teaches that a bad tree cannot bear good fruit, nor can a good tree bear bad fruit. And by their fruits you shall know them. Clearly, the fruits of Christina Gallagher's ministry in the houses of prayer have been good not only through the validation of her predictions, but importantly, because of the large number of spiritual conversions and physical healings from Almighty God. Here are two of them.
In a few moments, some of the people who have been healed, these are people of the hundreds who have been healed, whose cases have been investigated in depth by medical experts. And one of the doctors involved will also speak to us. I would like then to introduce Kathleen O'Sullivan from Listowel in County Kerry. Kathleen was given up or dead. Her file was put with the deceased. There were three consultants treating her. One is a professor of medicine in the National University of Ireland. She was only 5 stone weight when she was sent home to die. Her husband had just heard of the House of Prayer here in Achill. She had been given a Matrix Medal, which is the medal Our Lady gave for conversion and protection through Christina. Her husband felt he had nothing to lose. The case was utterly hopeless. And he drove her here. She was lying under a duvet in the back seat of the car. She couldn't even sit up. She hadn't been able to take solid food. When he carried her in his arms for Christina to pray with her and brought her into the chapel here, she was instantaneously healed. When she came out, she wanted to sit in the front seat of the car, and as they approached Galway on their way back to Kerry, she said she felt hungry and could they have something to eat. She ate a full meal, and ever since, day by day, week by week, she grew perfectly strong and healthy, better than she had ever been before she had the diseases. Dr. Michael Anquetil, whom I will also introduce to you here today, sent her back after he heard, on the occasion of a visit here on pilgrimage, after he heard of this healing. Being a doctor, he knew that pancreatic cancer advances painlessly. Then he sent her back to each of the consultants again to undergo the tests. And they wrote their reports after careful examination and analysis and found that there was no medical, scientific, human, or psychological explanation for her healing. I just invite Kathleen now to come forward and say a little prayer of thanksgiving.
After an ultrasound, Mrs. Finola McManus's doctor told her the baby in her womb was lifeless and would have to be removed. But Finola refused the procedure until she could pray with Christina Gallagher at the House of Prayer in Achill, Ireland, which she did. On her return to the hospital, an ultrasound was performed, and to the absolute astonishment of the doctors and nurses, a heartbeat was discovered. A month later, a perfectly healthy baby was born, remaining so today. Prophecies given to Christina by Jesus as far back as 1995 and again in 2006, indicating that fire would rage in North America, are being fulfilled in California. An additional message was given to Christina on October 12, 2019, which stated, California flames will rise high upon all those filled with their own pomp and false security. So many in their pride adore the world and its fruits. All that is not of me is wasting away. These fires are little. There will be many more until they open their hearts to recognize my hand crushing evil. Tell the people of California they must honor me, their God. Jesus and Mary's warnings to Christina Gallagher have now become reality. The coronavirus. On July 16, 2002, the Blessed Virgin Mary said, "Diseases will fall upon many, plagues will devour many." On February 22, 2005, Jesus said, "There will be an epidemic throughout the world, with a germ bred through AIDS. Many innocent people will catch it and die. There will be a virus-type plague, which will kill many throughout the world." On January 26, 2013, Jesus said, "The world will endure many diseases and plague diseases that will be man-made." The virus is now a worldwide pandemic, killing many thousands of people, swarms of locusts. On March 29, 2009, the Blessed Virgin Mary said, "Locusts, such as has never been seen before, will form a plague. It will seem as if they themselves have an evil intent, as if they have an awareness. They are to wreak destruction." In October 2012, Jesus said, "My people, hear and respond as I have called you. Worse turmoil is on the way. Locusts will come and devour you while you are spiritually asleep. Swarms of voracious locusts, floods, and food shortages in East Africa are affecting 10 million people in Ethiopia, Somalia, Kenya, South Sudan, who now face unprecedented difficulty." At a meeting in New York in October 2019, Father Gerard McGinnerty and Christina explained to a gathering of people the situation in New York, at present and urgent need for a house of prayer.
"And put in place what Jesus has pleaded with you in his great love and mercy, the financial aid in your freedom for a house in New York. Even in the midst of us saturated in evil, and it's deserving nothing more than to be crushed and devoured, yet he still, with a merciful heart, crying out to you to do put this house in place, and he will protect the island of New York. Otherwise, you don't stand a chance."
On September the 3rd last year, as we were returning from the houses of prayer, Jesus said, "I desire a house of prayer on the outskirts of New York, but only if it is put in place swiftly. It is of the utmost importance to to save souls and for the protection of New York and its surroundings. People are to listen, and this time let there be no excuses if they desire safety. It will not be said again. There was a pause, and during turbulence on the flight, Jesus spoke again. Have no fear, for it is I who brought you here, and you speak truth in my wisdom for all to hear. It is only the foolish man who permits his ears to become deaf, so as not to be able to perceive my wisdom and truth. Yet many ask questions and make comments and judgments which wound my sacred heart. It would be better for such people to open their hearts and recognize it is I who am speaking truth through my vessel for all to hear and recognize. I desire this house on the outskirts of New York as a must for many to receive protection. For there will be many there who will be able to respond and uphold it. There were those who shut their ears and eyes and permitted their hearts to close to my call, and justice is about to come upon them. Great disasters are to come to many parts of the world, and especially in the Americas. Leaders in authority in the Americas have become very united in the darkness of the world. They welcome and hail all that is of death, and have brought to themselves all in the seduction of the powers of darkness. How the many within my church shame me. Woe unto you, godless men. Pray, pray, pray. People are completely unaware of the dangers about to befall New York. I plead with you to listen. Make haste and respond to what I ask of you. I desire to protect and help you, but you must decide, and failing this, you will draw upon yourselves great sorrow through the destruction of not responding. I beg you to make haste to put this in place. Let the guidance of this be with my vessel through the wisdom I have imparted to her.
Regardless of how we see darkness, we will see the church going into a very crisis stage very, very soon, just as the whole world is gone into a crisis where the sacraments of God is swept out. There's practically no marriage anymore. The sacrament is no longer wanted. It's lived together, commit adultery. If you take every one of the Ten Commandments, you'll see every one of them being destroyed. And you'll see all the authority and all the teachings and scripture of the Lord being watered down. But as you see this, you're not to lose faith. Because God is still God. He'll never change. And as you look at a crucifix, his arms are forever stretched openly with an open heart, waiting for you, waiting for the greatest sinner out there to come back. Come is his yearning love. Come out of the darkness and into the light. I want to bathe you in the light and bathe you and fill you with my life. Lord, the Lord's mercy is never ending, but people won't have a need for God's mercy, because as they go into the darkness, they won't even realize the reality of God. And the one thing I do feel here in New York is everybody is so busy. It's all about the flesh, fulfilling it, getting the biggest kicks in whatever ways, if it's drugs, alcohol, sex, of every description there is, it's all. Fill me, give me everything I want of the flesh. But unless we reject the flesh and the world, we can't allow God to grow in our soul. It's by reducing in self we allow God to grow within us, in our soul. And our Blessed Mother said in the early days to me, as you respond to what I'm asking of you, the light and spirit of God will grow greater in your soul. But as it does, you might as well be prepared. When the evil one sees it, he'll come to attack you. You give him his power by responding to him. He's nothing but darkness. God is life and light. And it's like going into a darkened room. When you switch on the light, darkness has to go. When you allow the light and life of God within you, if he comes in the greatest form to destroy you, have no fear. Because evil has no power over God. You give the devil power over the life of God in a mystical body, and you allow the Lord be tantalized by your partaking in sin. But the time for to respond to truth, to live in the life and love and mercy of God, then when you do that, you see life completely different. It doesn't matter if you're taken today, tomorrow, next week, you're ready because you're aware of God. You're aware of his sacraments, and if you love him, if you know him, if you love him and live in his truth, you won't have a fear. You'll have a peace because you'll know this journey is not your home. You'll know anything that's in it is of no use. And you'll realize the only home that exists in reality is our Father's home to the life of Jesus.
The movement to controls and how Christina was made aware in 1992 even about the uniting of currencies in Europe and then the cashless society and a one world bank, a one world government and a one world church. Now, the One World Bank is already in place, and the cashless society is well underway because, on the guise of security, we're going to be told it's much safer against possible theft and so on, that you don't have cash around, you don't have money, and the card is introduced. But the card, banker's card, that's only a step on the way to the actual chip itself, which will be inserted in the body, in the hand or in the forehead. And that's already mentioned in the scriptures. And we have had some chat shows on television in Ireland where, and of course, again, like so much else, they're deliberately staged in order to motivate people to go along with these innovations. And they bring on people who've already got the chip. And they're kind of a bit like guinea pigs, but they're there to praise the chip and say, oh, it's fantastic. I can open the door of my office now without looking for a key. Big deal.
I have read that the chip once implanted could be removed. Is that
no, correct? No. The chip is put into an area where it's beside a nerve that will charge the battery in your hand or your forehead. And it will unite with every nerve in your body. And it's in control of every part of your being through them nervous, through your whole nervous being. And as that happens, if anybody tries to remove it, it will kill you. Now, there might be mimicry chips put in that they'd be able to show you, oh, we can take it out. But it's not factual, the real chip. When the real chip goes in, it can never be removed, and your soul is gone.
Throughout history, God has sent his messengers, prophets, and his mother to guide us, enlighten us, scold us, educate us, warn us, and just be there to help us maintain conscious contact with him. In ancient time, there was Abraham, Moses, and the apostles. More recently, in the 19th and 20th century, we have had important appearances and messages from the Blessed Virgin Mary at Lourdes and La Salette in France, at Fatima in Portugal, and Knock in Ireland, in Kibeho in Africa, in Medjugorje, and elsewhere, inviting us to pray, return to the sacraments, and reconcile with God. We are being given every possible chance to amend our lives and make reparation to God because we are being urgently told that without change, serious consequences are in store for the world and for us individually. As you have learned in this film, Christina Gallagher is one of the few others in the world chosen to deliver serious, credible messages to mankind. Her warnings of past and current events have all occurred as Jesus and Mary said they would, through the houses of prayer. God has gifted her ministry with many physical and spiritual healings and allowed her to be a refuge for priests and lay people alike in their time of need. We ask that you pray for Christina and for the success of the houses of prayer in helping to heal where needed and to grow even more important in the conversion of people, cities, and nations. We especially ask prayer for the New York House of Prayer, currently under construction to be realized, and for the protection of New York from severe chastisement. Two messages Jesus gave Christina this year on July 15th and 25th gave serious warning about Lucifer's strong influence in the world today. The beginnings of each message follow, and we strongly encourage you to read the entire messages on the website christinagallagher.org. Message of July 16th. My shepherds, wake up. Plead for mercy while you still have time. Do not be foolish to assume when this virus is over, you will be free. It is a continuation of the great apostasy, the desertion of truth. How foolish you have been to abandon the house of prayer. How you and priests will fall and not be protected without God's grace. The world is now in the deepest darkness of hell, the Antichrist. Message of July 25th. Lucifer and his many minions, his legions rage upon the earth. His control is at every corner, as in the man-made virus, and many more illnesses, to strike fear into your hearts. Your fear should be of what his army are doing in the one world government of dictatorship and control of all that you own, and especially control of your person to destroy your soul. Pray, pray, pray for one another, for America, the church, and forgiveness from Almighty God.